Good evening, and I'm very happy and thankful first to my old friend who invited me here, but to all of you for having come to listen to me. Now, I think I would summarize, this is a very good summary, in one line. Marx and living Marxism, not Marxism, living Marxism, are more relevant today than ever, than it was even at the time of Marx's writings. For me, to be a Marxist is not to be a Marxologist. That is to start from Marx, even if Marx was really a genius and the start was the best one possible. But it was the start. And we ought to continue, to deepen, to analyze the changes in the world in the light of how he started it. Second, Marx was not an academic, and there is academic Marxism, possibly, but Marx wanted to change the world. But he was aware that you cannot change the world unless you understand it first. But understanding it, you learn from action to change it. The action is the only way to get Marxism developing. This is why we ought to distinguish Marx from Marxisms. And I would put plural, because, and that is normal, the not only individuals or thinkers or academics who studied Marx, but the Marxist ideas which penetrated important political and social forces that contributed, for better or worse, here and there, with successes and failures, to change the world. What is most important is to understand why they understood Marx in the way they understood it in their time and in their place. Not to put Marx to them, like a professor at university marking the student. This is good, this is bad, this is true Marxism, and this is irrelevant, or this is revisionism, and so on, which is polemical, but does not give its consideration to why the Social Democrats of the Second International understood Marx in a certain way, why Lenin understood it differently, why Mao understood it differently, etc. And why also communists here and there throughout the world understood Marxism. Not to put a mark to them, good or bad, but to understand why, what were the circumstances. Today, I want to come to some conclusions which will be the most important part of my introduction, of my speech. Two conclusions. One, what are the, in my opinion, the major and real challenges which the Chinese people and society, and therefore also state, are facing today. Today, not even 10 years before, today, and for the coming visible future. What are they? It's most important in order to try to be lucid and to try to have an effective strategy to face those challenges. And second, what are the challenges also, or the main challenges, which the people of the world, the working people, the vast majority in the South and in the North, are facing today and why we need to revive internationalism and organize it, not only at a humanistic, general, moral, I am an internationalist, I love other people and so on, but organize it. That is, we need the building of a new international, and let's call it, communist or not communist, an international of working classes and peoples, which is a concept a little wider than the working classes stricto sensu. Now, but in order to be convincing, I hope, I should make a long detour before coming to presenting to you what are those challenges. So that they don't appear to you as coming from the blues or from the particular ideas of Samir, Amin, without any argument or proof that it is worthwhile being considered and discussed. I'm not sure that I'm right, but I would give my arguments so that you can accept them or reject them with arguments also, not just with positions. Now, in order to do that, I think we have to look into what is essential in the capitalist, not mode of production, in the capitalist society throughout its short history, relatively to other the history of other societies, such as yours or mine, the Egyptian. We are not new nations, we are nations since 5,000-6,000 years. But in order to understand that, we ought to make, to clarify some fundamental concepts and fundamental conclusions or deriving from those concepts about that reality. I think, personally, I have been a reader always, all my life. I have read all Marx and with attention 4 times in my life. I discovered that was every 20 years, from the age of 20 to the age of 80. And it happens to have coincide with important changes in the world order. And therefore, I think, right or wrong, that what I'm deriving from those readings is Marxism. It's not the exclusive way of understanding Marx, but it is Marxism. I would not say that understanding it in another way would be a wrong way, but a different one, and for which reasons? Now, first point one, we ought to distinguish what I call crisis within capitalism from the crisis of capitalism. These are two things different. The crisis within capitalism, there has been continuously and many crises of a variety of nature, economic, cyclical crises, political, social, coming out of class struggle and history crises, which have been led to capitalists being able to move ahead to give an answer to those crises. But the crisis of capitalism has a historical mode, historical period, which is coming to its end, and which we should look at, and I dare say, capitalism, we have entered in the age of senile capitalism. Society, an organization of society, which cannot anymore produce anything progressive. You know, the capital accumulation is based on a growth, exponential growth. Exponential growth is the pattern of the growth of cancer, which means it leads by itself necessarily to death. Therefore, that pattern, which is inherent, which defines capitalism, cannot be continued. We have to find another type of development, if we call it so, of society. Not only for the South, but for the whole world. Perhaps the ecologists have, I would say, rediscovered that, because in my reading it was already announced by Marx. He understood it. It's a good thing that people who have never read Marx rediscover it 150 years later by themselves, which means that rationality leads you to the same conclusions, and this is a good thing. But it was already there. And this is why, and this is my reading of Marx, Marx considered capitalism as a short bracket in human history. A short bracket of a few centuries, one, two, three centuries. We are Chinese or Egyptian. We do consider that one, two, or three centuries in our history is a short period. We are not North American, who consider that 10 years is a long period. a bracket. Why? Why? And that is very important. Marx discovered, and this is our starting point, the fundamental contradiction of that system, which makes it non-viable in, say, the long run. Beyond class struggle, which is a platitude for anybody who has a minimal realism when he or she looks at reality, social reality, throughout history. Beyond that, in book two of Capital, Marx divides the production, the capitalist production, he doesn't look at other patterns of production, into the famous two departments, production of means of production and production of consumer goods, and how they are related. And he look into, and he put figures to continue his development, how reproduction of that system, enlarged reproduction, that is, reproduction of that system with a growth of, say, 3% per year, from one year to another, etc., could function. What are the conditions for, and those conditions are very rigorously related to, one, the division of labor, second, the productivity of social labor for the production of any good, equipment or consumption, and he derives them, the those conditions. But that could lead the superficial reader to think that, okay, capitalism has its own rationality, but it functions, and it can therefore function, let's say, forever, or at least for a very long historical period, and give legitimacy to that system. That is what conventional, what Marx called vulgar economics, want to says, but is unable to prove, that the system a generalized market, market of all production would be commodities. All natural resources would be turned into commodities, including land, perhaps even atmosphere, etc. And labor is also a commodity. That this system of generalized market lead naturally by itself, by its own working, tend to an equilibrium. There can be disequilibria, but they can be overcome by and within the logic of the system. All of them, before Marx, Bastiat and others, after Marx, and even the most brilliant, clever people like Walras or like Sraffa or like Keynes, have failed to prove it. Now, the Nobel Prizes are usually given to people who have all failed to prove anything, but they are given precisely for that reason. They pretend to have reached the goal, and the academic consider that they have reached the goal, and the next day they are forgotten precisely, while Marx is not forgotten. Who said the other? He analyzed, therefore, the system as a system moving from one disequilibrium to another one without tending to any equilibrium. Now, in book two, Marx shows, I would say, that the fundamental contradiction is that the conditions for reproduction are in conflict with the fundamental rule of capitalism as a social system, that is, having the lowest possible wage payment for labor force, and therefore that there is a tendency of profits to be always too large, the opposite exactly of what the conventional economists say to their governments. Wages are always too high and profits are always too low. It's the opposite. Profits are always too large and wages are always too low, which would make the system unable to operate. This is why it's a short bracket. It has been at the time of when Marx was writing, particularly the Communist Manifesto, 1848, his age was 30 years old, and capitalism, in fact, existed as a dominant mode of production in a very small part of the world. England, not even Great Britain. England, northeast France, a quarter of France, Belgium, and a very small part of Western Prussian Westphalia. That's all. Elsewhere, even in Europe, it was not yet the dominant. And yet, in spite of that, Marx discovered what is the future of that system. That is, one, that it will conquer the world. Not only the whole of Europe, but the world, very fast, in a number of decades. And that it will not be able to go beyond that. At that point in time, when it has conquered the world, then it enters into senility. It has to be replaced by something more advanced. Now, therefore, Marx was very optimistic. This is what happened. Within a few decades, the whole of Europe, at various degrees, of course, became capitalist, plus North America, a little later Japan. colonies did exist before from the mercantilist period, but were generalized or semi-colonial, like your country, through wars. The Opium War was the first one, never forget it, in China. The good friends of the West have started in that way to integrate China in the modern world. So I'm not, it's a very, a series of very important problems, but this is not my problem, to look into what were the challenges, the crises, and how they were overcome in order to achieve this target of this of the logic of capitalism. But to come precisely at the point when it became senile. That is, reached a point where the income distribution, the distortion in the income distribution, could not anymore be compensated by further expansion of capitalism. I think that Rosa Luxemburg, before many other Marxists, understood that in the early 20th century, 1900, around 1900, before First World War. And therefore, that the system was facing with a starting crisis of capitalism. Now, we have had two, we can give them a name, long crisis, because it covers decades and not years, systemic crisis, because it's a crisis of the system. We can call it as you want, but I would call them a crisis of the system. Two long crises. One started at the end of the 19th century, and the second one started, and we can put a date, 1973. I will say later why. And it is the one in which we are living. Now, capital reacted to capital as a, the owners of capital, the capitalists, and the capitalist class, represented by their political power, the power of their governments, their states, how they reacted to that crisis, long crisis of capitalism. By three sets of measures. One, moving towards monopoly, giving transforming capitalism into a system of monopolies. You can call them oligopolies, if you like. And deepening the power, the economic and political and cultural power of monopoly, of monopolies. Second, deepening the globalization. Globalization is nothing new. And I would even say that globalization existed even before capitalism in other forms. The Silk Road, for instance, not the new project of Silk Roads, but the, those which existed earlier are proof of that. The expansion of religions, moving thousands of kilometers from one place to another, is a proof of that. Modern globalization started with as a response to that, which means modern deepening the polarization between the dominant imperialist powers and the dominated societies, whether independent or not, whether more or less advanced in capitalism or not. And third, the running ahead into financialization. I will come to that concept later. That is in creating an outlet for excess of profits, which cannot be invested in the expansion of the productive system, That is, say, to use common words, organizing waste. good and bad, because education is waste from that point of view, but it's good waste. And health is waste, but it's good waste. But selling costs, which is to give a name to a mark, a trademark, and saying this is the best one and you have to pay for it, it's a real waste. And there are many other patterns of that. That was discovered early or late, as you want, 1960 exactly, by Baran and Sweezy, that we, for the analyzing capitalism today, let's say, as of his capitalism moving into the phase, senile capitalism, into the phase of decadence, final crisis, say. Now, with two departments, you have to invent a third department, department three, absorbing the surplus in a variety of forms, useful socially and very harmful or useless socially. Three departments instead of two. Otherwise, you cannot understand capitalism today. I think that among the academics, it is only a small minority of those who claim, and they have the right to claim that, to be Marxist, who considers that introducing the third department is absolutely necessary to understand modern world. But funny enough, if academics did not understand that, Lenin and Mao understood it. And it's important because there were not two academics. They led gigantic movements who came even to power, and in not small countries. So that is important in order to understand what is the... Now, senile capitalism doesn't mean that, like old person, they will die someday by themselves as a result of some circumstances or any sickness, but easily they will disappear by themselves. No, a senile system becomes ferocious because it wants to survive at any price, which means that we have entered into a period not of peace, democracy, end of history, rationality, etc., but exactly the opposite, a period of wars, possibly, and I would hope, revolutions or revolutionary advances, counter-revolutions, violence, etc. Now, how the first long crisis of capitalism was, what was the response of the peoples across the planet to that first? Well, a number of what I'm calling insignificant events for the conventional economist. First World War, the Russian Revolution, the crisis of 29, Nazism, Imperial Japan, the Popular Front in France and Spain, the New Deal in the US, the Second World War, the victory of the Red Army over the Nazis, the Chinese Revolution, Bandung, and the reconquest of their independence by the people of Asia and Africa. Well, this was the response. It was not it was not Keynes. This is blah blah to say it was Keynes. Keynes was a small part of that, very small. It was gigantic historical changes, good or bad, from our point of view, probably the revolution social in the name of socialism, the Popular Front are good response. Nazism or fascism or Imperial Japan are not the good response to it, but both existed. Both existed. So there is no reason why we do the response to that will be not also, and it has started to be so, a number of events which transform the world, whether we like it or not. Now, from there, I go to, now, how, what are the, oh yes, thank you, what are the characteristics of this second long crisis, and how, what are the main, major characteristics of the response of monopoly capital to that long crisis? I am submitting him here three characteristics which are partly new, or revival in a new form of what was done as responses to the first long crisis. One, reinforcing the power of monopoly capital, because monopoly capital was already there as a response to the first one, but reinforcing. And that led to a qualitative change in the degree of control, and I'm saying of control, not of property, of monopoly capital over the whole economic system. That is, all economic activities have been turned, I'm perhaps exaggerating as usual, I'm saying that often, but almost all, or more and more, into subcontracting for monopoly capital. Small enterprises, farmers, everybody. They remain formally independent, but they are de facto submitted as subcontractors, whether they like it or not, controlled upstream and downstream by monopoly capital. The case of farmers in capitalist countries is typical. They are totally controlled upstream by those who provide the credit, inputs and so on. They are all gigantic monopolies, and downstream by those who control the commercialization of their product. To the extent that the system of price, contrary to the saying of market economy that they are the true price of the market, they are artificial prices dictated by the dictatorship of monopoly capital, which reduce their income to zero in the case of Europe, for instance, to the extent that they are compelled, the governments are compelled to give subsidies to compensate them, and which means that the taxpayer, that the whole population, is paying a rent to monopoly through the false system of prices, reducing the income of farmers to zero or close to it. Now, that is one. It's a new stage. Now, here again, I have written on that. Other people, very important in my opinion, most of them claiming to be Marxists, some not even, just observers of so-called reality, have given the proof of that in detail with figures. So I felt myself comfortable in saying that it's a new stage of monopoly capital. Now there have been debate among some, a good number of Marxist academics, particularly in the Western countries of West Europe, France, Britain, Germany, and United States and Italy over how to qualify that variety of name that is semantic of little importance. Now, the second was to deepen globalization, not to invent globalization, because globalization was always there, but to deepen it. It is the so-called neoliberal liberalization. I, looking at what is the recipe for that globalization, the so-called conditionality that IMF, World Bank, and the European Union, the United establishment of the United States and Japan suggest as the recipe for everybody, is rather, I would call it, paleo-liberalism. That is, liberalism as it was understood by the early capitalist class in England in 1820. 1820, not 1920. That is, that the worker has no rights. There is nothing of that kind. And they do freely what they want. It's free market. So, deepening it, paleo-liberalism. And third, financialization. Again, this department three is the one which is growing. And it is growing exclusively, it's the exclusive department which is growing in the Western capitalist advanced countries, the triad, United States, Europe, and Japan, and which is growing even in the countries, and I would include China, where you have also a growth of department one and two, that is a growth of real production. You have the two. So it's less imbalanced, but nonetheless existing. The proportion of that department, three, to GDP, which was around 10% in 1913, before World War I, around 30% in the after World War II, that is, had moved along slowly, has been an enormous jump. That is, the curve is like that, exponential. During the past 70 years, and particularly growing faster during the last two, three, or four decades, which is the signal of senility, precisely. And that financialization now is the assessment, not mine. It's difficult to assess, to give exact figures, because it's a mixture of all kinds of things. And as I said, some are absolutely useful. I'm not for an austerity and reducing education and health. But that would be not waste, a good waste. I mean, at the expense of productive, of producing mobile telephones. Long live better education and better health and less telephones, but also waste. And waste is not just what appears morally as the worst of waste, armaments and destructive of mass destruction in particular, and so on. But all sorts. Now, that is not viable. Now, when I say that it is not viable, I'm immediately answered by bad people in the West and by good people in China. But the same argument. No, that is not what is happening. What is happening is a slow growth, very slow, in the old Western industrialized countries, in the triad, United States, Europe, and Japan, but compensated by a high growth in the South, unequal, and particularly in the socialist South, China. And therefore, what is happening is not a crisis of capitalism, it's a crisis of Western capitalism, if we could call it so. And the transfer of the center of gravity to other regions of the world, particularly Eastern Asia, China number one, but possibly also other countries like India, or possibly also other countries like Brazil and others. And I'm saying, I'm answering to that fact. But what is it exactly? What is happening as a result of that? That more ferocious hate and attempt of the old Western imperialist, traditional historical imperialist, to maintain their control over the whole planet by more and more violent ways. And one, they have done it. They are doing it every day. And they have done it with some success to this day. One, by abolishing in precisely the traditionally so-called democratic, bourgeois democratic countries of the West. Western Europe, United States, I don't know if Japan should be added to that, it's a little specific, but still. Into what I dare call a totalitarian system. It's no more democracy, it's a totalitarian system. Monopoly, centralized monopoly power is not only exclusively economic power and subcontracting for those who remain out of its reach, but also have captured the political system, captured the so-called electoral parties, right and left, and reduce them to be the servants of monopoly capital. They all have to admit the socialists, the previous social democrats, who were real social democrats in 1945, and who introduced a historical compromise to the benefit of the working classes, which I do not look at as something awful and revisionist, but as a limited but important progress who have changed the society to better, reducing them to accept so-called neoliberalism, that is paleoliberalism, becoming so-called social liberals. This is antinomous. You cannot be socialist and liberal together. Liberal means capitalist liberalism. Freedom, liberty for capital, not for the working classes. And that has delegitimized democracy. In the West, you can vote, and also in many countries, a masquerade, you have multi-party system or pseudo-multi-party system and votes. In some cases, they are not fabricated votes, in others they are. Free votes. But so, what is the result? The next day, the parliament meet and say, we cannot do anything. We have to obey to the demands of the market, which is the polite way to say monopoly capital. Angela Merkel said it in a very naive way. She says, you are free to vote, but you should understand that you cannot, your representative cannot run, but within the limits, the boundaries of the rationality of the market. So why do you vote then? A humoristic friend of mine wrote as an economist, why do we have so many economists, professional economists, if they all say exactly the same thing? Name one, and you make economy by having no other economist paid. And he will say for the truth for everybody. So that is accompanied also by monopoly capital having captured so-called information or disinformation, the medias. The medias, which enjoyed a degree of variety in the past, are now repeating exactly the same thing every day, everywhere. It has been turned into a clergy in the service of the financial aristocracy. Now, it's also, they have captured so-called culture, that is, individuals being formatted to think that they are free individuals, while in fact they are being turned into consumers and spectators of the TV instead of being citizens working. So that's the new culture. Now, this is totalitarian. Maybe I should qualify it by saying that it looks soft totalitarian as compared to fascism, for instance, of the old pattern. Because it does not require from the people that they demonstrate their support. No, that they keep quiet only and think that there is no alternative. So you have to adjust day by day to what is the real world. That's enough. It's soft totalitarian, but that soft totalitarian can become ferocious if need be, here and there, and go to criminalize the demonstrations and the struggles against the system because it could become dangerous. Now, another feature, so the system is already there at that point, which leads also as a consequence to the best possible and the worst possible. The best possible is that not only some intellectuals, but through their struggles, people become more and more lucid about the reality and able, therefore, to develop a strategy of action, of struggle, which would be moving ahead on the long road, moving out of capitalism. That is, the challenge is not finding a solution to the crisis within capitalism, but moving out of capitalism in crisis. This was a title of one of my books, Moving Out of the Crisis of Capitalism, or Moving Out of Capitalism in Crisis. That is the challenge. The other main feature, which is new, imperialism is nothing new, but imperialism has moved into a qualitative change. Imperialism was to be conjugated in the plural. There was nothing called imperialism, but there was the British imperialism, American imperialism, Japanese imperialism, French imperialism, etc. And often in conflict among themselves, including going to war. Now I'm speaking of the collective imperialism of the triad, the historical major imperialist countries. Collective imperialism of United States, Europe, and Japan. One, what is the proof of that? The proof of that, there are so many proofs every day. You have NATO. They have organized themselves in one military alliance with a leadership, the US, and with what I call subaltern subordinate allies, not lackeys, allies, but subordinated. They can say, well, we don't like this, but finally they say, yes, sir, to the president of the United States, whoever he is. Now, why? Because precisely of that, they need more and more violence. They know more than we know, and more than most of the naive people in China think they know, that they cannot run the world, dominate the world, continue their domination, but associated and deeply associated, subordinate their minor conflicts to the common strategy against the rest of the world. We are a minority. We are only 85% of humankind, if you add Asia, including China, Africa, Latin America, the Caribbean, and will be more than 85%, 90% close in a few decades. But we are a minority. We are insignificant people. We ought to continue to be dominated. Now, everybody has to become conscious of that, and not to think that we can reach, catch up within that system, and that the imperialists, collective imperialists, will accept it. Perhaps because they are nice people, perhaps because they cannot do anything else, they will not accept it. So, when many of the Chinese people and others elsewhere, but I'm here in China and I want you to win, not to lose the battle, think that we had a high growth, it could continue within the global system, and we shall become the first economy in the world soon, and we can continue and so on. And after all, China had a long history, and we were one of the, or perhaps the most important area in the world long ago, will be again it, and that will be accepted. It is not accepted. You will be fought, including war, in order not to allow you to reach your goal. If you continue to be naive and do not take all the measures in order to prevent the catastrophe. So you have a big responsibility. So we are, I may come now, I'm close to 45 minutes, to the two conclusions. One, what is the challenge for you? I'm saying, starting, the triad will never accept a so-called prosperous, even capitalist, a fortiori, if you want to prevent something in the name of Chinese characteristics from socialism, will not accept it. And therefore, you see, you have an example. Yeltsin thought that getting rid of socialism, but getting rid of socialism officially and really, in the case after the breakdown of the Soviet Union, we accept capitalism as it is. And the model is the Western capitalist countries. And the model is United States, and the model is the capitalist globalization. We accept all unconditional surrender, unconditional submission to the rules of capitalism. And then we are going to be admitted as a European partner in European capitalism within the global capitalist system. What was the action of the West? Was immediately to destroy the Soviet Union and Russia, to try to and to achieve the goal to transform it into a subordinate provider of raw materials, a colony, and nothing else. So do take this lesson, historical lesson, into consideration. The strategy of the US vis-à-vis China is that one. It's not to accept, and I don't mean even, I don't go to say to support, but even to accept the success of China. And therefore, not be naive. To show that there are very real indications of the menace, I think we can take, it's not by pure chance that the United States establishment has chosen North Korea and Iran in the name of so-called denuclearization of the two countries to be the target of possible US-NATO attacks on them. Military. One is the east bound, close to China on the east, the other on the west. They have never, and they will continue to support the Dalai Lama and the so-called Tibetan independence of Tibet and independence and the most reactionary Islamic forces in Xinjiang. And they say it. Never forget that. They had even a plan to divide China proper, as they call it, into regions with different status in the global system. And there was a, there are documents for that. You ought to know them. And fortunately, those documents, even if they are called some of them secret, they are well known. Of the US establishment and signed or countersigned as approved as an ID by various presidents of the United States, including Clinton, not Trump, but Clinton, saying that we could envisage a war having and annihilating, that is killing, 600 million people in China, well, half of China of today. So, what can you do facing such a challenge? One, you ought to be lucid and know it and not naive. But that's not enough. You have moved, China has moved as of 1979 or more the next decade, the 90s, into globalization. It has moved into trade globalization, that is, its exports and imports are growing, have grown and continue to grow, have grown very, very fast. And you are even aggressive in that area, in the export area. Okay. Second, you have moved into a pattern into globalization of capital investment, real capital investment. That is, you invite and accept foreign capital to establish in China, and you have started exporting capital of China to buy assets elsewhere. But until now, you have put rules to manage that participating to the global investment globalization. That is, foreign companies cannot do anything in China. They have to be approved. They have to submit to rules, associate with private or public capital. There is a state interference, whether it is effective or not, whether so-called corruption limits its efficiency. These are, you should study that carefully. But this is your job. But China has not moved until today into financial globalization. That is, until today, the banking system remains a state-owned banks in China, or almost exclusively until today. That, along with the yuan being managed, that is, the rate being of exchange being decided by the Central Bank of China, which means by the government of China, not by the so-called market. Now, so you are not participating. The result until now is very positive in your favor. The result until now is China has, if you measure it in purchasing power, represent the GDP of China 18% of the global GDP, and if you measure it in current yuan or dollars, because the rate is fixed, 16%, very close. The difference is very close. India has moved into, was half before, in the time of the ruling previous governments of the Congress Party. With BGP, thanks to BGP, it has moved from 50% participating to the financial globalization to 100%. Now, the GDP of India measured in purchasing power represents almost exactly the half of that of China, that is 8%. But measured in current dollars, less than 2%. That is, participating to the financial globalization has given the possibility, the capacity of monopoly capital to practically transform India as a subcontractor. And and most of the benefit go to the Western global monopoly capital. So I'm saying, until now, you have a gun in your hand, not participating the Chinese. You have a gun in you. You are not a member, you are not participating to global financialization. Why should you give this gun to your enemy? Why? In the name of what? Because he's nice? The next day he will use it against you. So keep it. That is a very important point. It might turn to be a decisive point. The other one is that, and this is why I'm not, when I'm asked, is China capitalist or socialist? I say, it's not the correct way of asking the question. China is surely not socialist, but I can hardly say it's capitalist, because capitalism is based on the private property of everything, including and particularly land. And until now, with many concessions, but until now, the property, agricultural, agrarian property, remains the property of the state, with managed by the village communities, and with a target, even if it is not implemented really and completely, of having equal access of all rural families to it. Now, that is also has made you, is the basis of the historical wide alliance, social alliance, between the peasants, the urban workers, the middle classes, which was the great achievement of the Chinese Revolution and of Mao. This is the other gun that you have in your hand. If you suppress it and you allow land to be turned into a commodity, within a few decades, you will move from the situation of China to that of Brazil to compare. In China, China is a poor country. You have only 6% of the arable of the arable lands on of the planet. 6%. And you produce and you feed 22% of humankind correctly. I would not say beautifully, but correctly. Beautiful cuisine, of course, but that's another question. That is linked to this non-commodity property of land. Brazil have the rate, land of arable land to population is in the case of Brazil 17 times better than for China, not twice or three times better, 17 times better. But since Brazil, throughout all its history, has been a capitalist country, in modern history, and has admitted that land is a commodity, the result is that the rural population has been reduced to less than 10%, and you have two-thirds of the urban population who are living in slums. So that I would say, and I say it and wrote it, China is a poor country where you don't see immense poverty. Brazil is a rich country where you see exclusively immense poverty. Every day, everywhere. So, do you want to move from the situation of China of today to that of Brazil of today? That is the second challenge. Now, and I come to my last point and about the challenges. The same challenge that is how to face senile capitalism is met by the people in the West, in the Triad, and in the South, in the other countries of the South. And there are many movements and struggles against the results of that ruling of the system by monopoly capital of the triad. Those struggles have my sympathy, and I think they are perfectly legitimate, but they remain until today fragmented at local, national levels and at global level, fragmented. And the result is that they cannot develop a strategy, an offensive strategy. They are on the defensive. That is, we have acquired in the past this right, you are attacking, reducing this right, we try to defend it. They are on the defensive. They leave the initiative in the hands of their enemy. We have to move from there to an offensive strategy. We have an alternative project. And we compel you to adjust to our alternative project instead of us adjusting to your project. Now, we won't reach that goal unless the gradually, and it will take time. This is why history is long, and this is why declines are long period in history, not short. move beyond fragmentation at the local level, at the national levels, because it remains the place where you may have another government. By elections, I doubt, but by struggles which change the balance of forces. And at the global level. Now, Marx understood that from the very beginning. And this is why Marx did not write only The Capital, but he participated as the main founder of the First International. Internationalism for him was not, it's humanism, of course, but not, was not just moral humanism, it was to be organized. And as lucid as possible of the common interests that is the First International. Then the working classes of Western Europe basically organized themselves in a Second International. Then with the October Revolution, Lenin understood and created a Third International, for the first time a Third International after Baku, which was not exclusively Western European, but included people of Asia and Africa and Latin America. And we need something. I will not go into how and what would be the characteristics, but we need also to think of creating an international, just like the social forums, a place of free debates. Okay, free debates are good per se, are useful, but they have their limits. More than that, we need in order to allow to make possible common strategies and therefore common victories, what I would call not pompously revolution with a capital R, but revolutionary advances which create the conditions for further or later possible also step ahead in the long road to socialism. You know, Mao was very patient. Mao never said that 1949 was a socialist revolution. And the name of China is the People's Republic of China. It's not the Socialist Republic. It's not the bourgeois republic like Sun Yat-sen dreamt, like the Kuomintang tried and failed. But it was the people's. It's different. But people's mean can become, move towards socialism, or can degenerate and move towards capitalism. The two are there. And he knew that. And you ought to pay attention to where we are, and that the road to communism for me, and for Marx before me, is not a utopian dream. No, it is a higher stage of human civilization. That is where the principle of solidarity replaces the principle of competition. The main principle on which our common on which capitalism is based is competition. Not only competition between companies, but competition between workers, between nations, call them as you want. In some cases, I hate the word, it would be competition according to so-called races according to the color of their skin, but competition. Communism is a society based on the principle of solidarity. Solidarity between individuals, between partners in a nation, call it as you want, at the global level, between nations. Now, it's another higher level. That, and again, I go back to Mao. When Mao was asked, when will that be reached? Oh, he said, be patient, Chinese are, in 1,000 years. he was probably voluntarily exaggerating, which meant not tomorrow. But we ought to go in that direction and prepare it, prepare what the utopia of today to become the reality of tomorrow. Thank you.